The last time I saw you, it was the X Factor tour. I don't know if you remember. It was me, Jess, popped in to
see
you and your brothers.
That seems like a long time ago, to be honest. It's crazy. Yeah, it's mad how quick time flies by these days. Makes me feel old.
same. Like, because when I actually first met you, you were in Neon Jungle. It was in the Echo Arena again. Every time I saw you, it's been in the Echo Arena, which I find hilarious.
There's something about the arena, you know?
I know. And you were 17.
Oh, don't. You make me feel old, like really old. I'm only 23 as well, but see, I actually started going grey. And I always blame it on Neon Jungle because I started going grey in Neon Jungle. Probably I just got it from my granddad because he went all white at
I'm saying, hence the beanie, like, nah.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I don't want to go full Philip Schofield just yet.
Yeah, no, he pulls it off, actually. He does.
Like, actually, that I wouldn't mind being Philip Schofield, Hootens. But I want to talk, you mentioned Neon Jungle there. Like, you guys absolutely tore it up. What was it like that whole journey looking back now? Because it was like, what, 2 years was it? Like, climbing the charts?
I think 3 years, 16. Well, I kind of signed just turning 16, so I was like 15. And then I left at 19, actually. So yeah, it was a fair bit. But maybe there was like a kind of solid two and a half years that people were in people's faces, per se. But that seems so long ago. It's crazy, but at the same time, you know, when you look back, certain things feel like yesterday. And I know, like, if I met up with the girls, it would just be like I'd just seen them yesterday. Yeah. In reality, I've not seen them in a while. However, I know we just go back to that same kind of place, which is nice. It's nice to find that kind of friendship.
Yeah, because, like, you were so different as well, because, you know, there was only, I believe at the time, Little Mix. I mean, I think Fifth Harmony were just on X Factor when you guys were, I think.
Yeah, I think when we first came out, I don't think they were even started yet. I'm not too sure. But no. I remember Little Mix being about, but maybe Fifth Harmony was a bit after.
Yeah, well, let's talk about, like, when was this to you? Because I've never seen you open, I think it was Summer Live in 2013. Right. And people didn't really know who yous was. And then following a year later, 2014, like the whole of the place just lifted. What was that because it was like quite a quick rise to fame.
Yeah, do you know what? It's funny you say that, because I actually remember like the first time we had done like an arena tour. And like you say, nobody knew us at that point. So it was kind of like, you know, you go on, you do your music, but the crowds, they would listen, but it wouldn't be as kind of perceptive as you would hope. But obviously people don't know who you are, so, and you know, following that, they'll go into Instagram and I think, oh, do you know what, I actually quite like this. And then, like you say, the next year we came around and done the arena tours. It was crazy because people, like, as soon as the Neon Jungle thing, you know, our logo and our picture and our video came up, the crowd just went mental, and we were like, whoa, is that for us, kind of thing. And I remember actually that feeling before stage. So yeah, it was quite a quick kind of rise. But we had a great team around us and that as well, so it was good to have all those kind of different avenues. And
I was about to say, how did you deal with it being so young? Because you were literally a teenager, you're 17. How did you deal with that whole rise to fame?
I loved it, man. Like, I think, to be honest, it didn't feel unnatural to me, to be honest, because I've grew up, luckily enough, in a musical family, and growing up seeing my dad doing.
Yeah, I was about to say, your dad was in music and stuff, and your brothers as well.
Yeah, so I never really, it wasn't like, oh my God, what's this kind of thing? I'd seen the ins and outs of it before. I knew it wasn't all sunshine and roses. And, you know, I knew it was hard work and, you know, you've got to grind to do your craft and make music. So it never, ever felt unnatural. And when I tell you, I used to pray every single night, I used to see myself up there in arenas. And, you know, when it happened, I was just, you know, it didn't feel strange because I had been there before in my mind.
Yeah.
Visualization.
Wow. See, that if that was me, that would terrify me, because I'm just like, I've thought about this so much.
Well, it showed you like the power of the universe, and that it's crazy. I'm a big kind of believer on that.
I wanted to talk about you just mentioned it there. You come from a musical family. Did that put like pressure on you at any point to kind of, this has to work?
I guess this has to work has always been a pressure that I put on myself. but pressure from my family, like, but there's six kids in our family, and I was the only one that sang at the beginning because the boys were all too shy. And that was never, that was just something that I kind of stepped out into my own and wanted to do. And then the pressure from me, but that's, I'm just quite a hard person on myself, I'd say. Even now, like, anything I do, you know, I need to do it 100% and put my all into it, because for me, I'm like, yeah, this has to work. And if things don't work, then I'll learn the mistakes and make sure, you know, I drill it into the next thing that's that I'm doing.
Let's go back to kind of your Neon Jungle days there quickly, because when it came to the songwriting process, is there anything you've kind of, you've talked from that journey that you took into the X Factor journey?
Songwriting, no, that was probably, that was a venture of my own, rather than in Neon Jungle. I mean, we dabbled in it a bit, but like, I kind of found my own style and stuff like that, separate to that. And just, again, inspirations, growing up, seeing my dad writing, that was all kind of a personal journey. But, I mean, the music's different as well. So that's a great thing about music. If for me, it's a feeling and a mood. So it doesn't matter what mood I'm in. My music can always be different. And, you know, with Neon Jungle to Soul. Are you still there?
Yeah.
Do you
hear me? Yeah.
I just got call coming through, but yeah, it's all different. Music's a feeling, and I always say it's universal. Doesn't matter what language is in, people can always kind of feel it and vibe with it.
What was the biggest journey, like, well, the biggest, like, difference between sort of them tours you were doing as Neon Jungle and the tours with your brothers? Like, that must have been kind of two completely different experiences.
Yeah, I mean, it's weird because some of it was the same arenas.
Yeah.
Obviously, some of it was different as well, but the, like you say, like, the full experience was different in terms of, like, you know, damn, like, I'm actually up here with my blood, you know what I mean? Like, that was a crazy kind of feeling to be following in the footsteps of our dad and, you know, literally repeating history for us. That was, you know, it's such a huge thing. And it's when you're on stage and you look left and right and you see your siblings there, like, you can't beat that feeling.
Yeah.
Especially when people shout our name, because the Cut Kelvins is not the easiest name to say. So
no, it's not. Especially for us Scousers. It's very similar to something else we say a lot.
I know. And the other day I was on, like, this like, important Zoom meeting, and I was like, literally running late. And so I was outside, and then these kids were going, excuse me, are you the Cut Kelvins? And I was like, oh my God, I'm so embarrassed. But then I thought to myself, it's mad that, you know, they're picked up on the name, so I was dead happy that he said the name properly, because you get a few confusing names in that as well. So,
and you guys were so different as well, because we've seen it on X Factor before where family groups go on and people don't necessarily get the vibe with you. You were so different, it was so unique. What was that kind of going into that first audition? How was your mind process? Because obviously you had this wealth of experience, your family has. Do you reckon that gives you an edge going into the X Factor journey?
For me, I felt kind of like pressure in terms of, like, being in, like, Neon Jungle and that before, because it's like you're getting shone in a different light and, you know, you're doing different stuff, and it's like, how's it going to look, and how is, you know, people going to perceive it, kind of thing. But, you know, it was a completely different experience, but there was a kind of pressure that I kind of felt on myself. Which it kind of died down, you know, after you get into the swing of things. You just think, you know, stuff what people kind of think, and you're on there to, you know, go on and show the world your music, show you. But the X Factor experience, we actually went on with, you know, R&B stuff and you know, our own material, and it kind of changed throughout the show.
But
it's a good experience that we had, and not many people can say they've had that as a family, so it's definitely something we'll talk about when we're 80 years old, I'm sure.
I'm guessing you've spoke about it a lot as well over kind of the lockdown and interviews and stuff. With another sort of thing is, I know you're massive and you've been very open on this on social media, as you're one for supporting, you know, the up-and-coming artists. What advice would you give them now, in because, you know, there's not much support out there for artists right now with the global situation?
What advice
for someone who's been in it? How does that make you feel, for one, and what advice would you give?
I mean, I was on the phone to my uncle, he's a singer in that as well, and you know, we was talking about how hard it is to hit musicians these days, And as hard as it is, I think the main thing is to try and stay as consistent as possible. And right now, the main outlet of that would be through social media. And social media is a powerful thing, whether it's through TikToks or Trillers or Instagram, whatever it may be, like posting up your videos and doing your thing on YouTube. Because I actually got signed for YouTube. That's how I first got my
record.
Yeah, so you never underestimate the power of social media. And then there was a singer called Donnell, and he was on The Voice. And then he got signed during lockdown from posting up videos. So although we're in our house, there's still creative, you know, things that you can do to be seen and just try and take advantage of that as best possible.
You say that, taking the most of your opportunities. We can mention it now that you're now part of BBC Scotland. Tell us how that came about, because you're a part of the introducing team now.
Yeah. Well, funny, they actually slid into my DMs talking about social media, yeah. I was like, what's this? And then, I followed it up and then had an email and, you know, discussed about it. And that was all because it was, you know, during lockdown, it was initially just a Zoom meeting, and then managed to go in and luckily got the job. I don't know how I got it, but here we are. And it's a step into the unknown kind of for me, because I've done interviews and all that before, but always on this kind of side.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? So like when I'm in the seat, like where you're sitting, I was like, oh, this is different. And I like that, because I feel when you put yourself in situations that you don't necessarily feel fully comfortable with, then you grow. So even now, the show's not even started. The show starts this Friday. And the amount that I've grown so far, just, you know, through doing we've done like mock-up shows and stuff like that. Yeah. So
because it is literally just you, a microphone and your voice. Did that scare you at any point? Because literally, obviously, as an artist, you're on stage and you talk to an audience for, a minute or so between songs, and then you're singing a song. Was it weird to sort of sit there and talk about something that you would actually want to talk about?
Yeah, because when we do performances, the thing that makes me most nervous is not the actual performance, it's talking in between songs.
Yeah.
It don't matter if it's 10 seconds, 15 or a minute, I'm always like trying to like rehearse, like, what am I saying? And that was always a huge thing for me for Indian Jungle. That was a bit I was always bricking at. And then, you know, you get used to it. You practice more, and then before you know it, you don't have to practice anymore. But being Scottish as well, and like moving down to London before, I always found people struggle to understand me. So it kind of gave me
I'm Scouse. It's its own language.
But it makes you feel kind of, what's the word I'm looking for? Like worried about it.
Yeah.
So, you know, doing the presenting thing, it was a step out there for me, and hearing my voice back on the first thing, I was like, oh, is that what I sound like? Yeah. But, you know, you got to get used to it.
You'll get over that, honestly, and then you'll be like, that was nothing. But is there anything you're super excited about? And what's the music scene like in Scotland? Because Liverpool, it's very kind of indie most of the time. It's gone into a little bit of a dance element. Tell us a little bit about the music scene in Scotland.
Well, before BBC Introducing Scotland came about, it was mostly indie music that kind of got played on a radio station, which is why this show means so much to me to be a part of it, and, you know, to be a person that's going to shine a light on all these voices and stuff out there, because going into the BBC Uploader and seeing the amount of styles, artists from all ages, like, it's insane how much music there is and talent in Scotland, which hadn't been... I didn't even know about it before, so it's really opened my eyes up to it. So I feel like the show is going to put a great outlet and spread the word about for more people, and like you say, there'll be people out there for me that people out there like me that didn't know how much artists and stuff are undiscovered, so it's going to be good. I'm excited for it.
Does it feel weird when you think back now to them YouTube days?
No, because I still, even the other day, I mean, I posted up a video on Instagram. I still, that's just me, you know, like, I still do that kind of stuff. And I was going to post that one on YouTube because it was 4 minutes odd long. And my mum was like, yeah, it's a bit long, Shireen. So I just like to post up singing videos anyway. But I'm pretty sure my neighbours downstairs do not like it. But oh, well, what are you going to do?
Exactly. Another thing as well, because obviously you and your brothers were releasing music. You released two amazing videos which got like amazing reception. What have you been doing, working on during kind of this year? I know, because, you know, touring's not going to be a thing for a long while by the looks of it. What are you doing to keep yourselves kind of active for yourselves as artists?
So, like, when the, obviously, we were in the studio, we were writing, and obviously, when lockdown hit, we were like, oh, like, we need to adapt to this here. So, Jay's got a studio, home studio, my younger brother, Brandon's got a home studio as well. So, there's two places that we've been recording within, you know, the luxury of our own, you know, homes, which has been great because we've been able to write and actually put it onto the mic as well. Obviously, still kind of learning how to do the producing side and the mixing side of things, but to be able to put down demos and send them off to people, I mean, that's a huge thing. So yeah, we've been writing new music, different sounds as well, like experimenting a lot.
Yeah.
And I'm really excited about this because we've got a whole load of things that we want to do, all of the things that we are doing as a group and individually as well. And because we're a family, something that I love about the family.
Everything you're doing is literally in-house.
Exactly. And we understand the business. So it's not like, oh, we're in a group, so, you know, you can't do that, you can't do that. We are open to getting as much avenues as possibly, as possible, you know, for the Cut Kelvin. So there's a lot of different stuff coming up. And something I've always wanted to do was release some solo stuff as well, which I'm going to be doing that too. So
so excited about.
Yeah. That's something I wanted to do since I was a kid. What's that?
What can we expect from, like, your solo stuff? Because I've never talked to you for about 10 minutes at Summer Live about your music taste, and they're so varied. So you say solo stuff, and I don't know what to expect.
Well, like I said before, like it depends on my mood and stuff like that. For example, there's one that I'm getting mixed and mastered now, and that's kind of got a dancehall feel to the beat.
Okay.
But I like to sing. So it's obviously, I'm always going to be singing on it. Do you know what I mean? So I've got big notes, and I'm vibing on it. But I'm also a sucker for ballads and sad songs and stuff like that. So I can't help but go down that avenue as well. And just kind of stuff that shows off the voice. But also, I like vodka, so I like to party. So some party stuff too.
Yeah, fair enough. Great. Yeah. I was about to say, don't go all Lewis Capaldi on us now.
Oh, he's brilliant, man. I love his music.
I just love his social media. He's brilliant.
I was on his social media last night, and yeah, he's just insane. The fact that he puts just so much personality is just why I love him so much, and probably the same for the world. Like, he just doesn't care, which is great.
I feel like he's got a Scottish sense of humour, because I've also spoke to, like, Nina Nesbitt, and she has the same, and you do as well. And I feel like some people don't fully get that humour.
Oh, 100%. I was literally having this conversation yesterday as well, because if you're not, like, Scottish, or that you have with, you know, Scottish, even though you get Scottish pages and stuff like that, and it's all Scottish jokes, and I'll be busting up and sending it to people on Instagram that are from England, and they're like, that's not funny, Shane. And I'm like, oh, you just don't get it, man. Like, it's good to get that banter, though.
Hey, let's talk about your solo stuff then. Like, does that nerve you from stepping away from, because you've been in a group predominantly throughout your career?
Yeah.
Is that a terrifying aspect to think, right, this is just going to be me and my, what I want to get out there and my message?
Didn't think about it until you said. No, I'm joking. it's something that it did scare me before, but not anymore. I feel like I'm ready to take that kind of necessary step. Like, I'm still going to be doing, obviously, the BBC. I'm still going to be doing Cut Kelvins. But as I said, I want to get as much avenues out as possible. Yeah. And I'm not too bothered about that anymore, but it was definitely something that kind of was a daunting thought about stepping out on stage by yourself.
Yeah.
But yeah, but now the fact that there's no live music, I mean, if that happened and I could do that, I'd be just like, oh, thanks. I'm be grateful for it kind of thing.
I'm gonna throw an idea out to you, like, for the Cut Kelvins. Will you do a podcast? Because you used all three of you, when you're in a room, I've seen Instagram stories, it's always absolutely hilarious. Would you ever
consider doing a podcast? Yeah, I'd really love to do that, actually. I think that's a really good idea, because honestly, the amount of times that we're in the house, like you say there, and I always think to myself, that should be filmed, because the stuff that we come out with, it might need to be like an 18 plus podcast, because
it's fine. You'll just rate it on Spotify. It's great. It needs to happen. Yeah.
That's actually, do you know what? Afterwards, I'm going to say that to the boys, because that's actually a really good idea.
Don't worry. I'll make sure you do. I'll email you and make sure you do.
Yeah.
I actually asked you a question one of my colleagues asked uses Neon Jungle? And I just want to see if your answer has changed. I don't know if you remember this question being asked, but what would you rather have, springs for arms or springs for legs?
Wait, I can't even remember what I would have said. Springs for arms or springs for legs?
So you still have hands and feet, but your actual arm would be spring or your leg?
What's the point in that?
Exactly.
Probably springs for legs, because you can just like jump over.
Yeah, you can jump over stuff. You'd be really sick at football.
Yeah, exactly. But then nobody would want to play with you when he's like jumping over them all. You're like, oh, I'm not picking her. Yeah, probably springs for legs, because yeah, I use my arms a little bit more. It'd be weird like hugging somebody and it's just a spring in it. What a random question.
You're welcome. You can ask that like to someone else when you interview them. I just throw these questions to people. I'll just like see a friend and just text them a random question. Like another one is, yeah, you could like be a kitchen cupboard spice,
kitchen cupboard spice. Mine would be jerk for sure, jerk spice.
See, I've got Chinese five spice.
Did you? I need to be careful with my spices now, because I ended up having anaphylactic shock recently and I've nearly died basically, and I didn't even know I was allergic to all this stuff, and then now I need to be super careful and it sucks.
See, I'm like that. It's like I'm not allergic to anything that I know of, but I feel like one day that's gonna like bite me in the backside.
We've got to be careful. You never know. I've got like EpiPens and stuff I need to carry with me like all times. It's stressful. It's so annoying.
One question as well before I get, because this proper intrigues me. I'm more for supporting local artists coming up. Is there any in Scotland you kind of really like have caught your eye that you'd like to tell people about?
Yeah, there's a few. There's a few on the first show as well. And I might be biased for this one, but my younger brother, Brandon, I feel like he's the dark horse and he's going to just blow. Like, he writes all his own music, and he's into mixing it all, and he picked that all up over this last year, and it's just came out. And there's a Drake song that's out, and every time I hear it on the radio, I actually think it's Brandon, and that to me is, like, crazy. Like, I definitely would put him in that category of Drake, and he's 19. So, like, I feel like he's definitely somebody that's going to blow. And that's not even me being biased that he's my brother. Like, I can just look and appreciate.
When you look at your entire family though, you were at a young age at a very high level, now your brother's doing the exact same thing. Has he ever came to you for advice? Obviously you've been in, you know, the media spotlight a little bit longer than they have. Did they come to you, especially before, like during X Factor, to be like, how do we do this?
We've always been quite open. You know, them coming to me with advice, me coming to them with advice, and whether it's in music or life or whatever. Even in love, sometimes I say to Brandon, like, what are you doing now, and try to give him advice. He's like, listen, I don't want that, keep that away. Yeah, we're always quite open with that, and that's, you know, one of the great things about being in a family that's kind of so connected, that you can share that aspect of things, even if you don't want to hear it as well.
Because I honestly can't wait till live gigs sort of thing, and you guys can either come down to Liverpool, Manchester. Honestly,
I feel like everyone needs to
see the Cook Calvin's live, because yous were my highlight when we got to see yous on the X Factor tour. Like, because that was a hell of a night. What was your highlight there, quick, on being on the X Factor? Did you have a like specific show or moment backstage that kind of you went, this is, yeah?
My highlight was definitely the tour, like all the live shows that we done on the tour, because we could be more us.
Yeah.
And you know, there was less directions to be their version kind of thing, so you know, we were a bit more free, and just in general, like my brothers, I'm pretty sure I can say that was their highlight as well. They were out partying all the time and I was there in the hotel, like I was like, no, I can't, I'm gonna lose my voice, because my voice is so sensitive, honestly, it's ridiculous. One night out and the next day, like I'm gone, so I had to kind of take it easy.
I want to wish you well for all you're doing. I'm sure I'll speak to you again in the near future with everything in the BBC. And if people want to keep tabs on what you're doing, where can they find you on socials?
Yeah, Shireen Cutty on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, all the same name, Shireen Cutty.
And who are you listening to right now, dead quickly, favourite song right now?
You know that Fleetwood and Mac song that's came back out into the charts, Dreams. Yeah, from the TikToks. I mean, I think that's on everybody's playlist right now.
Well, I'm going to play it straight after this interview, so thank you.
Yes, I'm going to bring back the old school vibes, you know?
Yes. No,
my neighbours are going to be hating me, honestly.
Oh, no, they won't. Of course they won't.
No, I'll be stamping on the floor dancing. I'm not a very good dancer, so...